independence of path is a remarkable property. Use the theorem that tells us that the existence of an antiderivative grants this property. Well, let us look at this theorem in the video and learn why this is true. Well, what was the theorem? If f of z is continuous in the domain D, then a, b, and c were equivalent. So if one holds and all three of them hold, so f has an antiderivative, capital F, then the integral from z1 to z2 does not depend on the path, and along any closed contour, the integral will be zero. So we will first prove A implies B, then B implies C, and then C implies A. And if you have all three of them, you know that all statements are equivalent. So from A to B. So suppose C is some smooth arc set of T between A and B. And given we have an antiderivative, we have to prove that the value of this integral from z1 to z2 does not depend on the path. Well, we know we have our antiderivative. We know if we differentiate, we can use the chain rule that equals df dz times z prime. And df dz is, of course, f of z, and we just leave z prime. So what happens if we compute the integral along c of f? Well, how do we need to do that? Well, we have to parameterize the c, and then we have to integrate from a to b, plug the parameterization in into f, and multiply by z prime dt. So there we have. But this f of z of t times z prime of t is exactly the derivative of capital F. So now we have a real integral of some derivative. We can use the main theorem of calculus for that. So we know that this is the capital F in z in b minus capital F in z in a. But z in b is z2, and z in a is z1, so that this is capital F in z2 minus capital F in z1, which is statement b. Now, going from b to c is not so difficult. So what do you do? Take any closed contour and split it into a c1 joint minus c2. So c1 goes from z1 to z2, and minus c2 also goes from z1 to z2. So this is z1, and this is c2. So c1 joint minus c2 is a closed contour. So we know that the integral along c1 equals the integral along c2, because we have b, the integral does not depend on the path. So that means that the integral along c equals the integral along c1 plus the integral along minus c2, the closed contour, but the integral along minus c2 equals minus integral along c2 equals integral along c1 with a minus sign, so it equals zero. And there we have c following from b. Then we have to go from c to a. This one is slightly harder. So given the fact that your integral along closed contours equals zero, we have to prove that we have an antiderivative. Well, we define our antiderivative as follows. We have a capital F of z, pick any z0 and integrate until z, f as ds. And due to b, this is independent of the path. Now, the only thing we have to show that indeed this is an antiderivative, the only thing which we need to show is that the derivative of capital F equals small f. Well, that's the last part. Actually, quite some work still. So what do we do? We have our z0 over there. We have our z, and we go slightly further along a straight line to z plus delta z. And we define our capital F of z like this. And then we have to prove that the derivative of capital F equals small f. So what do we need? Capital F in z plus delta z minus capital F in z divided by delta z. Take delta z to zero and show that this equals F of z. And then we're done. So there we go. We compute F in capital Z plus delta z minus capital F in z. By definition, it's like this. So we can simplify this integral, take them together like this. Furthermore, from z to z plus delta z, we go along a straight line. So the integral from z to z plus delta z ds, so the function 1 yields delta z. So that means that if you multiply left and right with f of z, you get f of z times delta z, you can take that inside the integral, because the integral is along s, so not along z. So you can, so it's a constant with respect to the integral, so you can take it inside. So you get f of z times delta z equals integral from z to z plus delta z, f z ds. So notice that these two are almost the same, apart from the fact that the first one you have f of s, so f depends on s, and you integrate with respect to that. And on the second one, z is fixed, so the integration doesn't feel that. Simplify the second formula by dividing by delta z, you get f z equals 1 over delta z, integral from z to z plus delta z, fz ds. And then combine those two. You have your this formula over here, divide by delta z, you get this term over here with the f of s. Subtract f of z, which we have over here, which is also an integral, so we subtract the f of z, which is this integral over there. And the only thing we need to do is to show that this integral on the right hand side goes to zero. If you take delta z to zero, we have to be careful there, because if you take delta z to zero, we have a problem over here. We have a 1 over delta z, which tends to blow up. So, how do we do that? We show that the numerator goes to zero even faster. Well, we know f of z is continuous in z, so for every epsilon bigger than zero, you have a delta such that your f of s minus fz is smaller than this epsilon, provided you take s close enough to z. So that means that you can get your f of s minus f of z as small as you like. So what do? You take your delta z in norm even smaller than this delta, then you can estimate the norm of your integral. And the norm of your integral is now smaller than this epsilon times the length of the integration interval in modulus delta z. So you know, if you take the limit now to zero, and delta z to zero, you have on the right hand side your delta z over epsilon times divided by delta z. Those cancel out. You can get this as small as you like, so this limit has to equal zero. So that means that if you take the limit for delta z to zero of f of z minus f of delta z, you take the f of z here to the right hand side, this limit equals zero. This is just f of z, so the derivative of capital F is small f, and that concludes the proof of the theorem.